Hi everybody, thank you very much for inviting me once more time. So I think it's, in total, it's like fourth talk. Okay, so I'm running out of topics. So this will be about analysis of viral sequencing data. And okay, so let's go ahead. So this is about RNA viruses, how to sequence them. And okay, let's see. So mostly it's about sequencing like highly mutating RNA viruses, like hepatitis and HIV. So they are really a menace for humanity. So you see how many HCV right now, like 200 million have HIV, and every time, every year, more and more people get infected. Similar happens with HIV. And that's why like CDC has like this division, one division for HIV, one for hepatitis, including HCV. And we're cooperating with them. And that's what the talk will be about, how to analyze sequencing data. So one of important questions that people want to get from sequencing is to understand how to control, how to detect viral outbreaks. So for example, very frequently, say for example, HCV virus, like some technician, some nurse just like was infected, was injected herself with drugs, and somehow for whatever reasons she used also the same syringe for people, for patients in the hospital, and as a result, and then moving from one to another state, and as a result, she infected very many people. So how to detect that kind of stuff, that's interesting. So there are also recent viral outbreaks, more or less recent, in Indiana. And now, as I heard from CDC, very large outbreak of HB virus in California, by the way. Yeah, it started from homeless people. Okay, so what is it, RNA viruses? So what's the difference from RNA, like with DNA viruses? They replicate very fast and they have very high mutation rate. And because they have that mutation rate, as a result, simultaneously the same host has very many different similar variants of the same virus. So all these variants can be different, can differ in virulence, in how they escape immune response, and how they're resistant to drugs. So especially it's critical, for example, for HIV. So usually if it's like very high mutation and a lot of different drugs, so immune system doesn't work, it may cause even death. But if immune system kind of may work, then it's kind of not that bad. Okay, so what's next generation sequencing promises? So it promises to, first of all, to classify all strains and so on. And of course, it can, okay, we will see how many different questions, like intra-host viral variants to distinguish, as well as how this transmission is going on and how to check that. But still, for example, for HIV, there is no approved FDA NGS protocol, so still all HIV patients get just Sanger sequencing, for example. And we wanted to like try to understand if potential customers for our protocol that we suggest, and it's kind of very difficult. So to convince all doctors, okay, some doctors are like younger doctors, it's easier to convince. And the older one, yeah, we already tried it like, I don't know, 5 years, 7 years ago. Oh, it's a mess. We cannot do anything but those reads from HIV. No, and as a result, minor variants they cannot see. And as a result, they need to put more drugs. It's really a problem. So there is no such really protocol. It's all what is done is Sanger. And Sanger doesn't give minor variants. Okay, so questions to viral NGS analysis the following. So we'll just two topics, intra-host and between host or inter host or in outbreak investigation. So the first questions are the following, like what are the single nucleotide variations, like low, which of them are drug resistant, especially this is for HIV. Also, we know that really what is drug resistance, not exactly even SNPs, but the haplotypes themselves, because haplotype may be resistant to several drugs, while it, okay, so it may be accumulate together, maybe not. Also, what kind of questions will be interested is how will population, I mean intra-host viral population, will evolve. So is it like chronic or recent disease? So if it's recent, so we may do one type of, for example, treatment. If it's chronic, it should be different. And for example, should we resample, especially for HIV, it's important. For example, every year they go through this one. So, but every time they still use Sanger. So as a result, like every year they have new troubles very frequently. Okay, so this is intra-host. And inter-host or outbreak investigation, there are other questions. For example, if given two samples, are they related, either from the same outbreak or not? Maybe determine direction, who infected whom, if they infected each other. Also, the question is about how to, we have like many samples, we want to split them into clusters, each corresponding to outbreak. Next question is who will be the primary spreader? And also primary spreader or source of the outbreak is the sample exists among sequences or no? So we need to decide, should we continue sequencing? Did we already found the source or not? So usually, of course, it's not like standard, but usually all these outbreaks, they kind of star-like, almost like stars. So one host like infected all others. So with a little bit of exceptions, some movements. Okay, so inter-host viral population. So here, there is it's a basically long story. So with asterisk, we put whatever we did in our group. And there are many, many tools here, like for example, Savage was presented maybe 2 years ago. And what I will present is like, we still haven't yet published it, like we have it in by archive, but not, we just continue to work on it. It's a ClickSNV, and we will talk a little bit about ClickSNV, and then like show some results. And also show how to validate different tools, because it's also a question. So our tool is working basically like, what it starts first? First of all, it's supposed to be, of course, aligned, so all this whatever how reads obtain, all these reads get aligned to certain consensus or reference. That's reference-based. And basically all references exist, but even after alignment we can get a consensus. After alignment, we are looking at all pairs of SNPs or in a such way that if, so we want to distinguish pairs of SNPs which are, they're either very well correlated, I mean, okay, not very well, they're strongly correlated, okay, correlated more than we expect if they would be independent, okay? So if they're correlated, this means that we assume that there is, it's kind of implication, indication, that there is a haplotype which where both this, with this, both these SNVs included. Then we have, that's this type, these green pairs. And there are pairs which are like strong indication they are unlikely to be in the same haplotype. And like somewhere in the middle, those for which we don't know, they may be or may not be in the same haplotype. Also, if we have, for example, Illumina sequencing, in Illumina sequencing, it's happening that they may not cover the entire amplicon. So as a result, it's possible that some SNPs, which are supposedly like to be linked, we just don't see sufficient number of reads connecting them simultaneously present in the same read. Okay, so after we identify those so-called linked SNV pairs, we build a graph of them. Each vertex is a SNV, and we connect them if they're linked. So after that, for this graph, we find all clicks, and clicks kind of supposedly correspond to variants. The only problem is that because of this far apart SNPs may possibly not get linked while they're supposed to be linked. That's why we sometimes need to merge. We try to merge clicks. So, but when we merge clicks, we are looking at forbidden pairs, and we don't merge clicks if there is a forbidden pair between them. So it's indication that it's extremely unlikely that these two clicks correspond to the same SNP. So after we collapse, so in this case, for example, we have three clicks, and out of these three clicks, we were able to merge two clicks. So two clicks, click one and click two in one single click, and this is another one. So for each of these merge clicks will be one haplotype corresponding. So now we see this is one haplotype, this is another haplotype, and then we partition all reads. So whoever, we take every read and check if this read closer to this haplotype, we use it to get a consensus for this haplotype. If it's closer to another haplotype, then it will be to another. So in this case, we'll have two consensus haplotypes. After that, very simple step is just based expectation maximization based algorithm is applied to find the abundance. So in other words, relative frequency of each variant. So basically that the difference is like that we found that like with the other methods is first of all they use linking. This was the first, and forbidden pairs. So this together allowed us to get comparatively good results. So now I will just tell very briefly. So we have several data sets, some new data sets never reported, mostly new HIV sets. Then we have also influenza A virus. These are some data, some facts about this data, how far they are from consensus, how they're different. So it's interesting, for example, this reduced lab mix that was used, for example, by Savage. It's kind of artificial, kind of further from real data sets. Why? Because it's assumed, and that's what actually experiments show, that if a single sample, if you would take from one single host, then we will see in this sample much like closer variants to each other. So that's why. So here, for example, 2020 out of it's approximately out of 1,000, maybe it's too large. So maybe out of 1,000 position, out of 1,000 sites, maybe 3, 9, 15, this is a little bit more closer to reality. So this HIV-1, in vitro 1 and in vitro 2 were done recently through CDC. They really, we did that experiment. So it was kind of mock. So in other words, it was there were really produced those variants, and then whatever in certain proportions were put in a single sample and sequenced. Okay, similar is done with AAV virus. So it's the PAKBY. Okay, so the question is how to population metrics. So how to measure the quality of reconstruction, the quality of reconstruction of population. That's kind of not the simple question, because standard measures are sensitivity and PPV. But sensitivity and PPV are good if we are talking not basically about populations. So they don't even work sometimes from sets. For example, if we will reconstruct it one variant, and this variant almost the same, so one or two bases different, but we cannot say, oh, it's not sensitive because it wasn't reconstructed, this variant, completely. without errors. So this means it should be dismissed, or maybe one, two errors should be tolerated. So at least we need to distinguish if it's five bases apart or one base apart. So this kind of stuff. So it's distance we need to take into account. And second, of course, if the method can reconstruct at least frequent variant, at least that is good. So it should be punished less if it's the method cannot reconstruct rare variants and reconstruct frequent variants. At least that should be, so it should be taken into account frequency. Neither this distance nor frequency is in standard sensitivity. So that's why we suggest two metrics, like directed distance between predicted population and true population. And sensitivity can be viewed like this. So for example, it's a frequency. So for each true variant, we multiply frequency on the distance to the closest predicted. And we're adding that. So this is one. So basically, this is analog of sensitivity. Analog of PPV, it's kind of opposite. So for any predicted variant, we want to check how close it is to the true variant. So this is DPD, and we multiply by its frequency. So these two distances more or less correspond to PPV and sensitivity. And if we look and we compare several methods, so it's kind of difficult to compare, for example, with Savage, because it doesn't really, it gives contigs, but it doesn't give, like fully reconstructed from Amplicon, for example, variant. So that's why it's a little bit difficult. So what we compare, the closest two guys that we found, of course, like a little bit old, but very stable, pretty Haplan. And more or less recent, it's also from like 2 years, maybe 3 years ago, no, 2 years ago, Recomb Abase QR. So if we compare them, so we see these two metrics. So the closer it's to zero, the better it is. So we can see this. So most of the time we're winning. Most of the time, pretty Haplan is good. But sometimes, if you can see here, Abase QR also can beat pretty Haplan. So we also added consensus. So what is that consensus? Basically, why bother and like trying to reconstruct all these variants? Just make a consensus. Basically, what roughly speaking, Sanger is doing consensus. Okay, it's doing a little bit more than consensus, but anyway. So why not consensus? And consensus is across here. You can see here it's pretty good in PPV because okay, it's not that bad. It's very close, but its sensitivity is not good. So that's why it's somewhere on the top, always like this. So, but then we still want to do even better estimation. And we found out that, of course, Earth mover's distance is another very good population prediction, accuracy of population prediction. So what is it done? It's just simply a distance between two populations is equal to the flow times distance. So what we're doing is basically matching. We have two populations. Each population has frequency. Each population consists of haplotypes. Each haplotype has frequency. So we're matching haplotypes. So the entire frequency of one population matches some frequency of another population. So that is a transportation problem, and it can be solved exactly. So EMD between two populations is equal to the flow times the distance between these two variants. So EMD becomes like really, originally it was invented, of course, for, okay, was used at least, invented for many things. Was used for image, how to check if two images are similar or the same, distance between images. So, but by the way, we can use it also for this EMD to understand how complex is the problem, because sometimes so obviously there are very many different samples, and we don't know how difficult is it, how diverse it is. Okay, you can like do a lot of hand waving, but EMD at least will give you a number. So distance to the consensus, this is in a sense, it's how difficult the instance is. And if we will divide for the method, we will normalize by this consensus, the distance to consensus, basically it's kind of tell how much work this prediction method did, how much profit we're doing, why it's better than consensus. So if we also compare several tools, we put consensus for, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, these 5 benchmarks, and we can see for each benchmark what is the EMD. Okay, so in some cases we've seen, once more time for this case, we can see they very well agree with the previous measure, but we strongly suggest to use that. Okay, so the next topic, so we also want to know how and try to predict how haplotypes will evolve in this. In other words, for example, if it's a chronic or it's a recent infection. And also it's interesting, some evolution itself. So what is it? If you really look at all these, for example, sequences from a single sample, you see a lot of variation there, like kind of very random one. So obviously it's a product of interaction with immune system and some mutations, maybe some random mutation, but still we see, okay, is it random or it has certain order inside? And it was from my colleague David Campo from UC. He suggests, okay, let's compute fractal dimension of this sequence. So fractal dimension can be computed for just metric space. So what we're doing, we are finding the fractal dimension. Okay, for me it's just, let's say, rather than fractal, fractional dimension. So basically it may be 2.5, not 2, not 3, not 1, but fractional dimension. And the higher this dimension, the more complex it is. But it's interesting also another question. Is this fractional dimension actually exists? So we wanted to check if it exists or not. Okay, I can measure it, but maybe it's a garbage measurement. So how it's measured, it's like maybe measured like as a box counting dimension. It's a kind of equivalent of fractal dimension. So what does that mean? This means the following. It's a limit basically it's assumed power law. That's why limit of log of number of balls of radius r necessary to cover all elements in this metric space when r goes to zero. So when it comes to zero. So we need to compute this limit. Obviously, the smaller the radius, the more balls we need to cover. And we want to see how many balls, how fast it grows. It's like a kind of power law. So how to compute it? It's also not clear, but okay, I use some low bounds, which I used for some VLSI-CAD long time ago. So it's basically the following thing. So if we will sort all sequences in arbitrary order, okay, it's better to use some certain order, but it doesn't matter. And then we know that the number of balls should exceed. Okay, so basically, for example, if the maximum distance between two vertices is 10, for example, then we know the radius of ball 9, we should use at least 2 times. So if we have 3 vertices and minimum distance between them 5, then we need to, if radius is 4, we need to use it at least 3 times because we will not be able to cover any 2 of them with a single ball. So basing on this low bound, we compute number of balls because in general, finding number of balls, minimum number of balls in pick-up-lead problems, but we're interested in order of runtime, in order of growth, so it's not that important. Okay, next. So what we've seen, so now, does it have this fractal dimension or it doesn't? There is a limit, there is a nice thing or not, okay? So what is it here? Okay, unfortunately, it's not a little bit. It's not 1 over radius, I think it's a log of 1 over radius, and it's not number of balls, but log of number of balls. Then we see, so real is kind of more or less straight line. While what we did instead of that, for each column, all this nucleotides like ACTGs, we permute. And we permute each column independently. And after we permute them independently, we run the same code to find what is this this limit and this value. Okay, so it's interesting. So as soon as you permute, all the curves look the same. You see, we did just 3 permutations here, but we are doing usually like 200 permutations. And then we found out that for certain kind of, I'll just say which one, for chronic samples, we'll see that it's practically out of, we have 250 samples, out of them 210 of them, always doesn't matter, any permutation implies that deviation from linear, from line will be more for randomly permuted, for all 200 randomly permuted, than for the guy who is real. Okay, so in other words, to a certain extent, we believe that this really this metric space has the fractal dimension, and this fractal dimension happened to be around 2.1. So if we will do that for recent infection, it's not that frequently. So sometimes it doesn't have that like linear structure. And whenever it has, it's around 1.9, so it's a little bit less. So at least we want to use, it's possible to use to distinguish chronic from recent, but not as good as other methods. So this is another question. So how to distinguish, how to classify chronic from recent? It's actually, we tried a lot of different ideas, okay? So we kind of have idea, model idea, why, how chronic should be different from like established, like several years, maybe 20 years, this infection lives, it's kind of accommodates itself with this immune system, but still evolving, but kind of different, whatever. We have like intuitive ideas, but it was still, and some papers appear before, something 80% accuracy was maximum. And then we offered to our machine learning group, and our own student suggested very simple, nice idea. So what is this? Maybe it's kind of known. So replace all these aligned variants. Actually, the main trouble there, that if you're chronic or if you are recent, it really doesn't matter, the number of variants may be large or may be small. It's very difficult to normalize because the number of sequences doesn't really depend on that. So, but something between them. So what she did? She basically replaced each sequence with a color, each nucleotide with a color. And that's what kind of image she has. And after that, just normalize this image, the size of the image. And it doesn't matter how many sequences were there, it will be the same size of the image. So, and then go to pixels. So after that, it's improved. So all methods suddenly start working very well. Okay, but of course, I mean machine learning, for example, SVM happened to be working better. Deep learning didn't work for some reasons. It's overdoing itself, okay? But you can see there, okay, if you can see, yeah, I think you can see there. I can see in my very small font. So it's like around 99, 98 accuracy. So it becomes very good, okay? So then we also tried some other characteristic. We try to understand and kind of coming close, but we still were not able to come close to SVM after image transmission. Okay, so you see it's both recall and precision are good, and for both, for chronic and for acute or whatever recent infection it works. Yeah.
So here, the order of the sequences.
Oh yeah, that was the interesting question. I asked from the beginning, but the order, because if you look at the, that's why I was kind of confused. So it's too nice picture. I see some weird in the middle, if you see some line, and somehow I couldn't understand it, but somehow it's happened to be always. It's just simply alphanumerical order. Okay, A greater than C, greater than T, greater than G, just like alphabetical, I mean, from left to right. Alphabetical order, whatever. And this somehow, it's always like that. So it's not like, so I see, what is this weird line in the middle? Okay, still for me, it's a problem. Okay, I don't know how.
Mm-hmm. So instead of doing lexicographic, if you do Listen. Reverse lexicographic, do all your results?
I think so, yeah. Yeah, yeah. I ask the same thing, yeah. But it should be sorting. It should be sorting, yeah.
Okay, so the performance will go down if you change the order?
No, as soon as I remember, not. No. Okay, it should be checking paper. That she did it. Yeah, I tried something with it. But this is a real question, okay? Yeah, obviously, if you don't order them, it will not work. So, but okay, it works. And it was like once more time. I mean, we try hard to get it. We never even get close to, even to 90, and it is 98. Okay, and you understand that you see here the numbers, it's basically improving all systems. So all kind of tools, not only SVM, which happen to be the best, works not that bad. Okay, so now we go to next, second topic. It's about outbreak investigation. So now we're not talking about what's happened inside a single sample in host, but what's happened between the hosts. So the questions like this, I just can repeat. So are two samples related? Who infected whom? What are the outbreaks? Cluster the samples into outbreaks. Who is primary spreader? Does primary spreader sequence or not? Was it sequence or not? That's kind of questions. But of course, this is always interesting from perspective, like human perspective. This is kind of like, imagine this is forensic studies. So what? Algorithms at the trial. So, and actually it's happening, okay. So for example, HCV, so my colleague Yuri Khodyakov, HCV, head of hepatitis bioinformatic division. So he is frequently called to serve for in court. Okay, so did you compare with Johnson's algorithm? It has high PPV. So you're telling me with your algorithm that this guy infected him, and maybe another algorithm will tell opposite way around. So it's kind of basically because it's kind of decided who infected whom. So it's a difficult question. But let's see, is it possible to do it in general? Okay. So for example, if you do Sanger sequencing, it's impossible because it's complete symmetry. Why A infected B or B infected A? You have two sequences, not clear at all. So existing approaches do fast assembly. So what I'm presenting right now is let's not do it. So what we're doing? We take blood sample, we sequence, we align reads, then do, for example, whatever our Clickerson V or somebody else algorithm. But instead, can we do without that? Can we get away without that? Why it's good? Because you may introduce some errors when assembly anyway, even if you're very good, still problem. And second of all, it also takes time. Of course, we will see that our algorithm. So as soon as you do preprocessing, you will do it with the KMRs. You will do much faster. So let's just check. Instead of assemblies, let disassemble reads. So make KMRs out of them. And now we want to compare the distance. Oh, okay, because it's two populations, once more, we will use MD. So how to find distance between two, for example, here, there are two sequences. So if we draw that sequences then and just cut out of them three mirrors, then we will see that kind of situation which is drawn here. And now, what's the distance between them? So we want to constitute. So in the De Bruijn graph, we can see the distance. So we can remove directions. And after we're removing directions, what we want to find the distance, we want for any pair of KMRs, we will find distance in the De Bruijn graph. So this idea was taken from David's and Sergei's paper about metagenomic studies. So instead of metagenomic, it's in sense metagenomics, but it's metavirus studies. Okay, so we have a lot of viruses inside since sample and we want to compare two populations. So after that, we can compute the distance between any pair and then we need to take this. So let's say this is one For example, one sequence, that's another sequence. We produce all k-mers from this. These are the sequences. Okay, in this case, it's happened to be all sequences are the same because it's short, but the frequencies, but maybe it's different. And then we need to make a match between them, and as a result, we can find find the total distance between this as a flow times the distance. Okay, flow times the distance, which will be EMD between these two guys. So now let's say we're already between any two samples, we'll find EMD distance. Now the question is how to answer those questions that well, that was all these epidemiological questions. So relatedness, not much of interest, but still, we didn't assemble the guys. So what we're doing is a threshold base. So basically, the rule in epidemiology, don't ever make any false positives. So if are not related, never tell that they're related. So we just take the largest possible bound. So take the minimum distance between unrelated area. Unrelated and use it as a bound. So as a result, what will happen? Certain outbreaks will be split into pairs of outbreaks, but at least we will never say that two unrelated guys we will not collapse together. So if we will just take two guys, we have large data with many outbreaks and so on. So then we will just for any pair say, okay, we know if they are related or not. So we check what is the sensitivity. So which pairs were classified incorrectly as unrelated while they are related. That's the count. For direction, we're doing the following. So for any, we take these two populations and find median populations. How to find median population? Of course, if you find just take arithmetic mean, it's not interesting. But if you take either quadratic mean, actually works the same, or so-called max mean. Max mean, we are doing the take for any k-mer maximum out of two population frequency, and then take all these maximums and normalize. Or is the same as quadratic mean, whatever. Quadratic mean or cubic mean, whatever. It's kind of basically works almost the same. There is no difference. So then the source of transmission we put to the one out of two guys, the one who is closer to the mean. The one who is closer to the mean. So clustering. For clustering, it was a little bit more complex. So we connect two guys if they're classified to be connected. But then after that, we join some clusters. So now it's interesting that if you have such nice metric space, what you can do, you can find the center. Center basically like whatever, arithmetic mean of all the guys. So for example, these are all populations. We can find the middle, find the radius, put a ball. And if some guy get into this ball, this means that we need to join these two clusters. So basically all nice geometry start working here. Because if you're just working in sequences, there is no geometry yet. So you don't know what is the middle, what is that. But here it becomes nice. You have geometry, population, so you can see. Actually, it's a set. We don't take into account frequencies here. So clustering is like this. How to choose the source for each. So basically, for source, we also try to find like this. So, okay. We'll not discuss it that much. Okay, so just go to the results. So we have from HCV samples that we got from CDC, we got, in total, we got 368 hosts. So each, they talk so-called HVR1 region. So very highly variable regions. Really, if you want to check who infected whom or whatever, you just need to look at variable region, and you don't really need the entire genome. So it's 10,000, and this is only 264 base pairs. So they have a good protocol for that. And so we simulated Illumina reads from them because actually original reads were from 454, but already have all technology dead, everything is dead. So we just simulated. We have simulators for Illumina reads, and then we've got these characteristics. Okay. So by the way, I just wanted to notice that. Just right now in Nature Communication, a paper appears about HIV they also like identify direction of infection. And okay, I don't have here algorithm whatever they use, exact their algorithm. But ideologically, our algorithm, the so-called red, was exactly the same as they use. So at least ideologically the same, and the results approximately the same. So you can see the direction of infection, and they also claim something like that, 87% quality. But if you do KMD, it's not very fast. So basically, it's very well clustering, works 100%. Also very, very good relatedness. So if we will compare all other methods, this, all other methods, they are based on full sequence. We know correct sequences. And this one is just based on the reads. It's not assembles and KMD. So if you compare all the results, somewhere we are not that bad. So everywhere it's good, something like that. So it doesn't make basically sense to try to assemble for this particular problem. So you don't need to assemble. It's already good if you just use reads and disassemble them into K-mirrors. So a little bit more difficult problem, it's a prediction of source presence. So if it's source present or not, so we just build here RSC curve. So okay, it's like 0.72. Okay, something good. It's not 50%, but it's still it's kind of difficult problem. So, but at least if epidemiologists see that it's somewhere, tells it like look like it's not present, then better continue sequencing. That's acknowledgments also. So this work was done within Georgia State University. Pavel Skubs is a professor there here. Slava Tsivina here present, who was participating in this project. So many of these guys participated in many CGSI meetings, at least in one. So this is HIV subdivision and hepatitis subdivision from CDC, Georgia Tech, and I work also with Russia. Now, what I want also, this is my important stuff, I want to present you 16th International Symposium on Bioinformatics, which will happen in 4th June of 2020. So I want you to mark calendar. We will send ad later. And so if you, okay, whoever haven't been yet in Moscow, so it will be nice excuse to go. And if you click, hopefully it will work. Okay, it's working. So we have already a website. We have it, yeah, Phil, right? Yeah, okay, good. So. And here you see, we don't have yet all this, it's 1 year in advance, but at least we have, for example, key days. So this means that, just imagine, let's call it average participant of CGSI. You're submitting your paper to RECOM, get rejected. It's a good time to submit to our content. That's why we put correct place for the deadline, okay? Okay, if you get accepted, who cares, okay? So we don't talk to happy people, it's okay. So, no, but our people also happy. I mean, they're not as maybe happy, but still happy, okay? So, usually we have around like, whatever, from 100 to 150 submissions, approximately 50 to 70, whatever, papers we get accepted. And what else? So we are just let's take the previous meetings. That's the previous meeting was in Barcelona. What?
Can't see anything.
Can I see? Oh shoot! How to do this?
Close the presentation.
That's what my escape. What? Okay, now I see it. Okay, good. Sorry. So this is our previous meeting. Okay. This is our previous meeting. It was in Barcelona. Like from 3rd to 6th June, okay? So for example, we can go further, but for example, previous meeting, we had good keynote speakers. Nika, who was, I think, giving talk here, also Martin Vingroen and Roderick Gigo, okay, so is a part. So it was very nice talks, and we have it, for example, if you, previous meetings, we also have it very nice, for example, Honolulu. So guys, You need to pay attention to good places, okay? Okay, so welcome, so we will send. Okay. And we will tweet, finally, yeah. I know what I need to do. Okay, thanks a lot.